17.6 million people, 5,000 water systems, and 5 million lead pipes still in the system. These statistics represent the state of our water quality and the extent of contamination. How many of us are absolutely sure that the water we are drinking is safe and contaminant-free? How often do we test for lead contamination in our water? Why would we? It all started about 3 years ago when I learned about the water crisis in Flint, Michigan. Did you know that peak lead levels reached 127 parts per billion? That's 9 times as much as the EPA standards for critical status of lead at 15 parts per billion of lead. I just couldn't accept the fact that there was a city in our country where children my age were exposed to a poison every day that caused lifelong damage to their mental capacity, vital organs, and even normal growth, all just because they were using water in their daily lives. To add on, this wasn't just a problem happening in Flint. This was happening all around the world, and we needed to do something about it. I started to look at what I could do. And in the beginning, I wanted to completely eliminate lead out of water. But when I thought about it, it was really complex, and it was like solving global warming with just one solution. But digging deeper, I found that the lack of knowledge of contamination and the extent of contamination was the bigger problem, as it kept people away from taking action and finding alternatives sooner. So detection became my primary focus. And then I started to look at what was already done. So some of the current solutions on the market today are either test strips, which are easy to use and fast, but aren't the most accurate thing in the world, or sending your water to a local water facility to get it tested, which is super accurate, but it's also time-consuming, inconvenient, and requires a lot of expensive equipment as well. So that really added on to a need for a solution as well. So this is when I moved on to the phase of looking at what I could do or what I could do with my invention. So I came across an article on MIT's page where they were using carbon nanotube sensors to detect hazardous gases in the air. And I decided to expand that idea to apply for liquids to be able to detect lead in water. So let me tell you a little bit about my device. I named it Tethys after the Greek goddess of fresh water. Tethys consists of 3 main parts. It has a core device with a processor, an inbuilt Bluetooth, a disposable cartridge, and a smartphone that connects over Bluetooth to be able to display your results. So how it works is you dip the cartridge into the water you want to test. The cartridge includes a carbon nanotube specially doped with chloride ions. So when it's dipped into water with lead, the lead in the water binds with the chloride ions, forming lead chloride molecules. This increases the amount of resistance to the flow of current and decreases the conductivity. The conductivity drop is correlated to the severity of the lead compounds in water. So to make it easier for the user, I added an Adafruit processor to measure all resistance and current values, and it has inbuilt Bluetooth low energy protocols, so it can send the data to your mobile phone once you connect over it on an app that I created, which gives you values of either safe, slightly contaminated, or critical of the lead status in your water. So that's a rundown of how the device works. So while I've been tackling the water contamination problem, I want to tell you a little bit about something else that I've been starting up and researching on. So one of the other biggest problems that is still happening now is the prescription opioid crisis, which is a huge problem. So some of my research, recent work has been about tackling that problem. So I've created a device for early diagnosis of prescription drug addiction. And it's able to tell you if you're at the onset of addiction, if you're completely out of addiction, or if you're already addicted to certain prescription drugs. So 50,000 people every year die from that. And early detection and early diagnosis could have helped many people, and I believe that my new device has the potential to help others with that as well. So the next thing I want to touch on is that through the journey of innovation, I wouldn't have been here, or I wouldn't have even had a device without the support of my mentors along the way. Innovation needs support and it needs mentors. It needs companies and individuals that foster independent thinking. So I want to thank all of my mentors for being there and supporting me whenever I needed it. And I'd like to request one thing from all of you. It would be that you seek a mentee and mentor them in the areas that they are passionate about. And I can tell you from personal experience, it has really made a difference for me. So, lastly, I'm a girl in STEM. And by the self, most people's instant reaction is, so what? But let me tell you a personal story. So, recently I was excited to join a STEM lab. And I wanted to make new friends and learn about new topics, but when I got there, it was me and 7 other boys. And my instant reaction was that I didn't belong here at all. Because if you go somewhere and it's you and 7 other boys, you don't feel like it's a place where you belong, and you don't feel like it's made out specifically for girls. But the funny thing is it was advertised the same for everyone. So I was really, really mad about it, but I was also really upset about it, too. But by the end of that lesson, I ended up loving what we were doing so much that it didn't matter to me who I was around. So somewhere in our mind, each one of us want to be with the group that we are a part of. And I personally, when I got there, I wasn't with the group that I was part of. My friends were all going to a movie or doing something else while I was there building a robotic car. And I would have much preferred to build a robotic car than go to whatever movie they were watching. But if there's one thing I want to change in this world, it would be to ensure that girls are provided a safe space to be able to pursue STEM and show their passion for STEM. So research shows that girls get into STEM necessarily for different reasons that guys get into STEM. So while girls look at more of the creative and artistic aspects of it, boys like to look at the technical and problem solving and step-by-step aspects of it as well. So if we're able to understand that, I hope to see a day where community clubs, schools, and organizations provide a space like this for all girls. And I want to end this off with one of my favorite quotes from my favorite scientist, Marie Curie. We've come a long way, but we still have so much more to do when we look ahead. If we all try to recognize and alleviate the problems that our fellow citizens face, we can make the world a better place. Thank you.